wave to Tim and Ruth. So, folks, what I suggest we do is that...
Oh, just by ask, who's Ruth's partner?
Oh, it's
Louise.
Ruth, your partner's Louise.
It says so on Moodle.
No, she didn't find it. She didn't find it anywhere.
Okay. what I suggest we do is we quickly, each group, try and walk the other group through what they did, identifying which steps were which and what decisions they made. You can do it in 3 or 4 minutes. I suggest that at whatever time, this may take a bit of time, so I suggest that whatever time Jeremy in particular needs to go or anybody else needs to go, just go. Don't wait for permission or anything. And whatever happens, we won't go on past 9:30, but this might take us to 3:15 or 3:20, especially if we're engaged in it. So is it easier for the group who were next door to talk us through your bits of paper which are on the wall here? We're interested in basically what decisions you made and what steps you grabbed, you know what I mean? To help us just help us to understand the model, basically. This is the second time you've done this, isn't it?
Never led.
Oh.
Okay. Facility days.
Okay, here we go.
So Jeremy was our presenter. Who gave us the scenario. Jeremy, do you just want to quickly say?
So when, as I mentioned, when we were all in together, I had a discussion with the vicar over lunch yesterday, in which, as a throwaway remark, he said that he didn't want to spend his evening watching the match, which was in his intention, with Christians. That was his phrase.
Yeah.
So we crystallised that as much as we could, and we thought about for maybe 5 minutes, you know, what he may have meant by that, why he said it to me, someone who didn't know particularly well and not from his parish. So that really set the scene for the discussion then and the reflection that followed.
Yeah, so we opened that out to people asking Jeremy to put some flesh on the bones, kind of that scenario. And then we decided to be...
Yeah, so, just to speak, so that's really... So what was the heart of the matter? Can you jump to that now? So what was the heart of the matter?
Was that it?
Time off.
Time
off.
Just time off or...
Not from the role.
Just really out.
Oh, time off, not observed an official role.
Time off, not observed an official role, is the heart of the matter.
And then you thought showered images.
Yes, that's
and
right.
And the image you came up with is...
Gone fishing.
Right, yep. Okay. How did you choose your interrogatory questions?
A team effort. Yeah. And then they each had the sheet of the questions on them. So they were two questions.
So you went for two different theological doctrines?
Creation and salvation.
Creation and salvation. Two questions are?
What is the most attractive in this world?
Yeah, and salvation
and
is?
What restores or brings balance?
Balance to this world.
Great. Okay, good. And you put your answers at the top.
Yes.
And then you thought out tradition?
Yeah. We did.
Which piece of tradition did you choose?
We ended up going for retreats.
Retreats, okay.
Yeah.
And then you asked the same questions of those?
Yes.
Yes. Then you compared and contrasted, so that now means you actually have step 11.
Yeah.
Yeah, step 11 is comparing and contrasting, steps 8 and 10. Did anything strike you at that stage? Any contrasting? Stage 11?
There wasn't much contrast. There was a lot of connections, but not many. There was one that stood out, but not really a contradiction. Just stood on its own.
Which was?
Prayer.
Then we went to culture.
Yes.
And then you moved to position, presumably?
Yes.
Were there any strong position statements that anybody came out with that were... You might not want to tell us, of course, it's your TR, private problem. Was there any strong position statements for that?
No. It was a collective one, really.
We
found more sympathy. We found ourselves to be judgmental initially.
Yeah.
But then more at sympathy with what we might have been trying to do.
Right,
thank
you. Yeah, I'm just come into it, you very often come into it with a position.
Yeah.
And when you've gone through the
yeah.
process, you
yeah.
find that your position
yeah.
has altered. It might be slightly,
yeah.
but it might be massively. And that's what I think, why my own thought since, you know, we did it in the week training, that this is a good way of doing things, because it doesn't lock you in.
In fact, one of the questions to ask yourself during or at the end of any theological question, using any different model, but using the language from this model,
yeah.
is, has my position changed?
Yeah.
And as you say, it can only just be a tiny little bit.
Yeah.
And if it's changed, then that is an outcome for the theological reflection, where sometimes people think a theological reflection hasn't worked unless we have an outcome like peace in the world.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, but sometimes it's actually you that changes,
yeah, yeah.
and that's the outcome
yes.
of the theological reflection.
Yes.
So any insights in the conversation at the end, anything you want to share?
Well, very useful to kind of do the dummy run in
yeah.
advance of the summer school, even though, you know, some Fridays last academic year participated in some, but
yeah.
I think the more you do it, the more it kind of jigsaws together in your mind.
Any questions from the group in here to them about their steps and process? It's about understanding the model, basically.
Well, my only question would be, when did you start and have a conversation between them? Did you start after two? You know, when you start to do comparing and contrasting, did you start that when you got two?
Yeah.
Like experience and tradition, or did you wait until you got culture?
No,
experience
and tradition. You did it at that, yeah.
yeah.
So as soon as you got two.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
In a sense, it's all a theological conversation.
Yeah.
Just at
yeah.
that point, it's a conversation between two sources.
Yeah.
And then once you've brought culture and positioning, you end up with a conversation between four sources.
Yeah.
And the conversation can break off and go anywhere you want at any time, because that's what conversations do.
Mm.
The purpose of mapping it for me is to actually know what you're doing. So if you know you're in, for example, in the experience, and you've actually wandered into a conversation about tradition, there's nothing wrong with that, as long as you know that's what we're doing.
Yeah.
Just one question that occurred to me. I seem to remember from last year that the running order was not that critical. So we came through it in a very structured sequence. We started with the experience,
yeah.
Got it down to this heart of the matter, related that to experience, and then went tradition, culture, position. But it's not mandatory to follow the steps in that order, is it?
There's a good practice and a discipline in each of the methods that are on the table, following the steps up to the generation of the image.
Yeah.
After that, which source you go to is
yeah.
is interesting.
Right.
You see what happens.
Okay. Right.
Which is not the same as starting a different source. Because
mm-hmm.
this starts in the traditions. This starts in the experience source.
Did you not ask the question, Bob?
No.
And you only ask the questions on culture if either you identified one piece of culture to ask them about, or you've got to ask them of all the culture you've identified. That's why the TR can be like that, or it can be endless.
Yeah.
Because there's no, you have to make some decisions about how to stop, otherwise you just keep going and going and going.
We were quite tight on the wrong sociology.
Yeah.
We could have drifted a little bit, yeah. but we knew
yeah.
that was a time constraint, so we were quite clinical on that.
We also commented that we felt quite pleased that we'd got sort of more to the end and been able to look back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that was really helpful to see that our position had changed and we weren't so
yeah.
judgmental about them now, and that
yeah.
it kind of completed the circle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's good to get.
It is, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And any one of your thought showered pieces of paper? Think of your, not here, but say you thought showered your images, for example, and you've got 10 images, and you choose one and run with it. Well, you could always restart the reflection again by choosing one of the images you didn't choose, for something different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
yeah.
why I say it's not like working out a mathematical equation. It is basically a structured way of getting into a conversation,
mm-hmm.
And a conversation can do go all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
That is the nature of it.
I should say that.
Yeah. Yeah. And one of the questions I know I'm interested in, therefore I know it reflects my position, if you haven't used the language in this model, is actually to ask yourself, if we'd done this a different way and just decided to reflect upon Jeremy's story, would we have unearthed those bits of tradition we unearthed, or would we have done something completely different? Mm-hmm. So part of my theory is that when you do this, you end up going to bits of the tradition, not just scripture, that you probably wouldn't easily or initially have thought of when you were first dealing with the situation. Mm-hmm. Did you get time to go back? Did you get time to go back and actually look at your story again to see if the Dutch reflection thrown insights onto your story?
Only from
when you position the change, obviously.
Yeah.
You use the word sympathy.
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Should we do the other one? Do the one now? I'll just swivel this around a bit so it gets more of the thing. We had loads of very brave people in my group, and I had to hold them all back because everybody wanted to leave, didn't they?
No,
it's just yes, Gavin. You end up leaving the first five sections. I can't remember. Liz told us a story about sitting with a person in church. Okay. So that's our thought shall analysing the story, the person sitting in church. Okay. And basically we end up with the heart of the matter, which is attending. We thought showered on attending, and the picture image we got was a sentry on duty outside an important place. So you've got a sentry outside a thing. And at that point Liz started to facilitate. Which is also quite interesting because in the model it's quite good to do that because actually we're not dealing with that person's story anymore because of the critical distance. So it was good that Liz said she'd have a go at this stage.
So on summer school, can I interrupt there? Sorry.
Yeah.
When there's two of us,
yeah,
wouldn't that be good practice then for one of us to present the
I'm going to wind you up here. That would be very, very, very poor practice because there's a third person doing the presentation.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Basically, at summer school, somebody will do what Liz did, and then two of you together will lead the group on that person's story.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So would you then take it in turns to do?
And that's why you're handing in those 200 word pastoral encounters, because
yeah,
by Friday night we'll decide at least which are the first two for each group.
Okay.
And so if you're down on Saturday morning to lead, you'll know by Friday night which person's story you're going to get, and it's up to you whether you talk to that person or not before Saturday morning, because there's no right and wrong way of doing that. Because again, you imagine the ministerial team meeting, you come together, and it's Liz's turn to share something in the ministerial team meeting, she just tells her story. And so you didn't know what was going to happen, but or conversely, in that ministerial team meeting that's coming up in your parish, Liz might have said to the rest of the team, by the way, when we get there, I want to tell you a story about what happened in church with sitting with somebody. So you kind of you half set it up. There's no right and wrong way of doing it. What we're trying to do is make it as realistic as possible as what might happen in a ministry team meeting. Well, I don't know about you, but my experience of those meetings is that most people don't know what's going to happen until someone does something like that. And that's the nature of life. And it's interesting because Dot was asking me about different models. And to say again, you don't have to use this model or methods at summer school. One of the characteristics of the pastoral cycle, one of the strengths of the pastoral cycle, as I understand it, is about doing your social and analysis. Well, if you're going to do that in your ministry team meeting, someone's got to do that piece of work before you come. You can't say, oh great, we'll just leave the ministry team meeting now while we go and do an analysis of the Central Warrington, because you can't. But on the other hand, you could come with a summary of this is the analysis I've done. Take the person's word for it, wouldn't you, because they've done the legwork, and you go with it. So again, it's working out how it would work in practice, and we're trying to emulate that.
Okay.
Cool.
So once we got the image, we came up with some interrogatory questions
for the image, and we decided to choose one doctrine with two questions.
Yep.
As opposed to, in this instance, as opposed to two different doctrines and questions from those.
Yep.
So the two different questions that we came up with were the doctrine of salvation. So for that one we had, what is the source of hope in this world? Oh, sorry, it's both. It's both salvation. So the two for salvation, what is the source of hope in this world, and where is grace in this world?
And they both came from that sheet that's printed in the summary from the last TR.
And then once we have those, so kind of imagining ourselves in that world, what was the hope? So hope is in blue. Where is grace? In red. So just an example, what is the source of hope in this world was that you've got an outfit that's waterproof. And then where is the grace that you might have good, cool weather? So once we'd done that, we moved on to tradition, and from thought shower, I don't know where our thought shower was. From our thought shower of things that related to the image, we came up with Lent, the idea of the season, the church season of Lent, and that's kind of where we began to come to an end of it, really. We didn't go all the way around, so we just had thoughts about what those questions meant to the season of Lent. That was us.
So any questions from the other group about the model that they used, the method they used? You don't need the whole detail of the TR.
This is one question that we talked about, is the different questions, which doctrine you pull from.
Yeah.
And again, is there any merit or no merit, or is it completely random as to whether you take from two different doctrines or not?
I can give you my only answer, because people ask me that question frequently, and my only answer is frequently deemed to be very unhelpful, which is that I think only intuition and experience gives you a hint about what might be the right questions to ask. One trainer I know used to say, sit down for a second, take 2 minutes out and ask, what questions does that image beg?
What questions?
But if you've got an image which, for example, in itself seems to be very salvation, very celebratory, I mean, that doesn't mean that you therefore ask salvation questions about it. I mean, it could be really interesting to actually ask the kind of sin-type questions to see what's going on in that world. So there is no obvious way of doing it. You just have to see how you feel. And when you're doing these over a period of time, like we're doing at summer school, for example, on day three, the mentors might say, the facilitators might say, actually, when we get to the interrogatory questions, unless it deems otherwise, we're definitely going to do atonement, by the way, because we've not done that this week so far. Because in a group that meets over a period of time, the more different questions you use, you basically build up your theological skills. You're honing your skills all the time. Because in order to do this, in order to use this model, you have to understand what atonement means, what salvation means, what creation. I mean, really understand what those things mean to be able to design effective questions. So there's no obvious answer. There's two bits of detail I want to point out in ours, but in a second, in case someone's got another question. The two pieces of detail I want to point out is that we've got Emmaus Road here and Mary and Martha in brackets. And I put them up there because those bits of scripture were talked about in our discussion about the person's incident. Yeah? So we've heard the story from Liz, and as we're doing our thought shout here on the story, then someone starts talking about Martha and Mary, somebody talks about Emmaus Road. It's all perfectly fine. But in terms of the model, you're trying to keep away from scripture at the moment. You're trying to think about experience. The advantage of mapping it is that the facilitator can write it up so that it's not lost, because you might lose it later. And quite frankly, it's now in the conversation because someone's mentioned it in the room. As soon as something's mentioned, it's a bit like the opposite of, don't mention it into it. It's now in the room. And the interesting thing as well is then to see how close or how far away the scripture that came up in the beginning is from the image we got to.
We had a similar thing, didn't we?
Yeah.
Because in our original discussion, who was it? Was it you? That mentioned the Jesus going up on his own.
Yeah.
And then we then put it into our tradition when we got to that. Although we didn't write it down at the time when you first saw it.
Exactly. So that's just so the interesting thing about using a process whereby you put something on a big space and have all your different places there. If somebody mentions something which is actually not in the quadrant you're at the moment, in order not to use it, there's no reason why someone can't quietly write it up where it might come later. Mm-hmm. And I think in our group, I think as I was coming in out of the room actually, my group talked about the fact that some groups always have another piece of paper all the time, which at the top has written on it insights. Because insights don't just come out at the end like a sausage machine. Insights come out all over the place, so you catch them and write them down, because that's the stuff to kind of remember, really.
Is that when we
Well, I think if theological reflection works, whichever model you're going to do, it's going to be the insight. So that's the stuff you're going to remember, because that's the stuff that changes your life.
Yeah.
I said there were three things. The second thing that happened in my group, which I didn't talk to them about at the time, is that when we were unpacking and the thought shower there of Liz's experience, two of the people in the group actually made references to both the Ewan Kelly book and the Jane Leach book, because we were talking about attending, and they pointed out that that's actually, someone said, this is like the Ewan Kelly book, isn't it? Where, I'm not sure, it's Jane Leach book where she talks about attending to the person that you're having the pastoral encounter with. And that's really beginning, for summer school, beginning to make connections between the, because we're using this as a tool to make connections to the theology we are looking at, which is the theology of pastoral care. The final one, which I didn't talk about in my group. This is the one I think I will take away from this week, my insight, is that when we were comparing and contrasting the things that came out here and our thought shower here of the original incident, even with the critical distance, here we have got that one of the things that this century that she or he might hope for or would bring them salvation is the opportunity, the chance to display their skills. What do we mean by that? In actual fact, somebody will charge the gate, or some kids will mess about, or a protest will come down the street, because that actually gives you the opportunity to just show what a fantastic century you are. Yeah? And we may not like it if it's not part of our culture, but if you're in the armed forces, you want a conflict. Because if there's nothing happening, you cannot demonstrate your skill. Yeah? It's a very human thing. The connection for me, Liz, is that in Liz's story, she went and sat with a person and then didn't speak and left about 10 minutes later. It's all about pastoral care. If we're really honest, we did that because we wanted something for ourselves as well. Mm-hmm. We're all in ministry, we're all getting ordained or licensed or whatever, because actual fact, we're doing it because God calls us in Christ. But we're also doing it because it fulfills a need in ourselves. Mm-hmm. And recognising that, which is the Ewan Kelly book, mm-hmm. is really, really important. So. Don't respond to this. I'm putting ideas into Liz's mind. There's a scenario whereby when Liz goes over and sits them, she's dying for them to tell her some really powerful, dreadful thing that's going on with her, so that then you can demonstrate your pastoral skills. But actually what happens is the person doesn't speak, and 10 minutes later they walk away. And that's like the century, hoping. I mean, the other side of the coin is the hope might be our hope is a quiet day, granted. But the other hope in his or her world is that something will happen so you can demonstrate your skill. Well, you might think what's a weird connection between, you know, the armed forces and the military and me wanting to show off my pastoral skills. It's the same thing.
Yeah.
But it's actually what's inside me wanting to shine. Mm-hmm. Whether I'm shining for Jesus or for my best friend or my tutor or the course or whatever, or the bishop. You want that because that's a very human thing. And to deny that, to pretend that isn't going on in ourselves, is what you and Kelly's going on about. I think that's actually not being honest on. Either not knowing ourselves, or we're still not being honest about ourselves. Because we know it, but we keep it secret, we don't tell anybody. So that's what I will take away about today, in our very, very simple story, was that he or she wants it to kick off, was the phrase we used, because then I get a chance to kind of, you know. Folks.
Can I just ask?
Yeah.
Step seven, the images explored using the imagination. Before you get to the questions.
Yeah.
What, could you just say a little bit again about, because you said people very often miss that bit.
Yeah.
How?
Go safely.
Bye.
Be wet.
So you can just a sentence
or so. Debbie's asking a question about step seven, because in our group, what the facilitator at the time did, which is what often people do, is they do step six, and because they've done this before and they're not following the steps, so not completely disciplined yet, then we jump to step eight. Step eight is actually asking the interrogative questions, but step seven is actually just going into this world and agreeing what that world actually is. So, for example, we often begin to do it. So in the group I was in here, we talked about a century. When the person drew it, they put an archway and stuff because probably at the back of the mind is kind of, you know, Buckingham Palace kind of stuff, you know, Westminster, that kind of stuff, you know, the guard outside, the hut behind, etc., etc. And it's to make sure that it's not a theological exploration, it's a kind of imaginative exploration, to make sure that when we ask the questions, we're asking the questions of the same world. That makes sense? So I think if you miss it out, it's not the end of the world, but what sometimes happens is that in asking the questions, you suddenly realise that the person next to you doesn't see the image like you see it at all, because we haven't had a conversation about what the image actually is. And another possibility is what you call standpoint. So in our group, because Debbie was one of the first people to make a contribution to answering some of the questions, she talked about what it's like for the sentry. But the image might have been somebody looking at a sentry on duty. This is me.
Yeah.
So you're talking about, when you say what's that world like, you're talking what's that bigger world like, or it could be what's it like actually being on sentry duty. They're both okay, but the imagination step nails it, because in there you talk about standpoint.
Good night.
Sorry,
that's
okay. That's
absolutely fine.
I think we kind of had that discussion when we came up with the image.
Yeah.
Some of the suggestions other people weren't comfortable with, and they explained why they weren't comfortable with it.
And that's also a good way of describing, because it also illustrates the fact that these steps are not essential. These steps are guides. So if you miss a step out, that's fine. It's not wrong. It's just that these steps help us to be disciplined about our theological reflection. I've been doing this over 20 years. When I wrote all that, I frequently, if you say to me, what step are you on, Gary? I won't be able to go on 9. I just know where I am. So the steps are really useful when you're new to it. I think it's really useful to have somebody in your group who is actually a bit pedantic about it, and actually says, are we on step 4? And you go, because you then realise that some people are on step 4, but some other people think they're on step 6.
Yeah.
So it's a really useful question. What step are we on? Rob?
On the two traditions,
yeah.
This group's gone very much tradition, very much Bible-based stuff.
This one here? We've got all these hymns and stuff here, though.
Yeah, but you've got Aaron, you've got Noah,
you've got Lent,
So, when we're talking tradition, it doesn't have to be Bible-based.
It's Christian tradition with a big T, which means everything that's happened in the Judeo-Christian tradition of the last 3,500 years. Instinctive, a lot of people, especially at summer school, Lord, when time is tight, often go for the scripture, because you can then go and get the Bible out and look at the passage. When someone says, like we did, let's do Lent, that's a bit tricky because that's a massive subject. So,
that's not what we have now.
Well, we've had Quakers, which is a bit different.
Yeah.
We had hymns, didn't we? We've got High Version of Lent.
We started off with Jesus.
Oh, did you win that thing?
If I was doing this as I do in a group that meets regularly, and Quakers came up like that, and the group said, let's go for Quakers, I'd say, right, well, it's getting on, let's have a cup of tea, go and find out about Quakers, I'll come back and we'll carry on with the TR next week when we know a bit more about Quakers. So in a similar way, if you'd have chosen a passage, if you've got enough time, if you haven't chosen Mayor's Road, before you ask the question, do you get the passage out? And you use that wonderful word, you do your exegesis. What does anybody know about this passage? And that all goes into the pot, which for me illustrates how exegesis informs but doesn't dictate the theological reflection and our theological decision making. It's something that goes in the pot. Now that very much suits this model of reflection when you're saying it's a conversation between sources. But some people won't like that theological position. They want a theological position which had a higher, gives more weight to the biblical aspects of the tradition, and that's fine. The model itself here doesn't say what weight is given to each source in this particular model. Other models might. Are we nearly done?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going if anyone's got other questions. It's absolutely fine. You're allowed to talk to each other. We're allowed to tidy the room. Sorry?
I'm literally not going
home. I'm just going to sit and wait like this.
Why? He was attending.
Should we give him a big hat?
Thank you.